It's a great pleasure to welcome Professor Sarah Otto from the University of British Columbia. Sally is a Canada Research Chair, is that what it is? CRC? Canada Research Chair, professor in the Department of Zoology, and she's the director of the Biodiversity Research Center at UBC. She was educated at Stanford University, both degrees, or at least 2 degrees, and worked with Mark Feldman, who you will hear from later. She's won many awards, even some that I've heard of, the MacArthur Fellowship, Guggenheim, and most recently, very recently, the National Academy of Sciences. She studies the evolution of sex, and that's what I think she's going to be talking about in her talk. I also just want to mention briefly the discussant will be Professor Slatkin, who is a member of the SFI Science Board and a professor at the University of California, Berkeley.
About the evolutionary enigma of sex and recombination, which is a point touched upon in the previous talk, in the question and answers in the previous talk a little bit. I think I can't really start, though, without also saying that I think in the last talk, you weren't making any claim that evolution couldn't have happened in the age of the universe. You were making a claim that it couldn't have happened if it was random and we just tried every single possibility, which is obvious. So, I know that this audience is very diverse, and so I want to first explain what the enigma of sex and recombination is. So, sex is a very costly way of reproducing. You basically take all of your resources and you divvy them up between daughters and sons, but it's only the daughters that themselves are able to reproduce. And so you basically kind of wasted half of your resources in terms of males, unless they're able to contribute parental care or otherwise increase the number of babies that your daughter reproduces. Otherwise, an asexual has lots of daughters, and all their daughters have lots and lots of individuals. So it's not a very efficient use of resources to divvy them up unless fathers contribute parental care, and in a lot of species they don't. So that's known as the cost of males. We're not talking small little cost. If you don't have any paternal care at all, that's a 50% cost and a 50% reduction in the ability of that species to reproduce. There's another cost that's actually more relevant to this talk here, and that is sex is a terrible idea in terms of destroying the gene combinations that you have when you reproduce. So here's my analogy. Imagine that you go to a poker hall and you've just gone through and everybody's had a round and you've got the winning hands that are left. And then you can ask them, would you like to exchange and randomize your cards with another winning hand? Nobody's going to say yes. And the reason for that is that the cards that work well together are the ones that allowed those hands to survive and win in the previous round. And the same is true with genes. That an individual that has survived to reproduce knows only one thing. My genes work well enough together that I can survive to the point of reproduction. And that's the only information that individual has. And so reproducing with another individual is, like with a poker hand example, a risky affair, because there's no necessary reason that the offspring that recombines those genes will do any better. And there's a good chance that it'll do a lot worse. So these interactions, in genetic terms, we call them epistasis, that the fitness is higher if you have certain combinations than if you have other combinations. And it's because of this, the interactions between the cards, that make card games so interesting. And I think it's the interactions between genes within a genome that makes us so interesting. So this is a big problem. Why break up what is tried and true? And in addition to all those major costs, you have the cost of finding a mate, the risk of not finding a mate and remaining unmated, the risk of disease transmission during mating, or the risk of predation during mating, as well as the time and energy costs of switching in organisms like yeast that I work on, where it takes 90 minutes to reproduce asexually, but about a week to kind of reconfigure the cellular machinery from mitotic divisions to meiotic sexual divisions. So we're not talking small costs, we're talking huge costs. And yet, the vast majority of eukaryotic organisms are sexual. More than 99.9% of eukaryotic organisms undergo sex, not necessarily every generation, but over the generations, the lineages include some sexual members. And this has become known as the paradox of sex. Why, in the face of so many large costs, are so many organisms sexual? Now, most of you have probably got the same answer in mind. If you've thought about this question at all, the vast majority of people will respond, it's obvious. Sex and recombination generate the variation needed by selection. Is there anything more we need to think about? This is actually an old idea. It goes back at least to Weismann in the 1800s, that the communication of fresh IDs to the germplasm implies an augmentation of the variational tendencies and thus an increase of the power of adaptation. So my first task in this talk is to explain why this answer is problematic. I'm going to do that in two parts. I'm going to explain why sex and recombination don't necessarily generate variation. And then I'm going to explain why those variants that are produced aren't necessarily the ones needed by selection. Okay, so let me deconstruct that problem with some toy examples. So here's my first toy example where I've made it really simple. I had one gene that controls or affects some feature. And let's imagine, so the population has got randomly sorting alleles to begin with. It's a diploid like us, and it's at Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. But in this particular population, there's a fitness surface that really strongly favors the extremes. So for example, the really tall ones might be able to survive a predation attempt, and the really small ones might be able to hide. Well, after selection, what will we have? We'll obviously have fewer of the intermediate ones that just got eaten. But now think about what does sex do in this population. If there's asexual reproduction, then those genotypes reproduce roughly at the same frequency, and we have a lot of variation in height here. There's a lot of really small individuals and a really large individuals. If it undergoes sex, though, it returns to Hardy-Weinberg, these randomly associated alleles, and as a consequence, variation in height is preserved by asexuality, but it's actually reduced by sex. Sex has taken the extremes that survived selection and made the intermediates and reduced variation. And this is just a toy example, but it's been proven generally both for selection acting within loci and selection acting between loci, the dominance and epistatic interactions that genes face. Then the general result is that whenever fitness surfaces are positively curved, so here I've got genotypes arrayed in some order of, let's say, increasing number of A alleles or increasing number of negative affecting alleles, that if the fitness surface is positively curved, then what selection does by itself is preserve the more extreme types. Selection generates variation, more variation than you'd expect if you randomly assorted the alleles. And consequently, when selection is doing that, sex and recombination will reduce the variation, taking those extremes and getting rid of them. So whenever there's this positively curved fitness surfaces, sex and recombination won't increase variation, they'll decrease variation. So it's only when fitness surfaces exhibit the opposite curvature, where the extremes are on average less fit than you might expect based on the intermediate types, so that that selection is actually leading to the elimination of extremes and causing more and more of those intermediate types to build up. And it's only in this case do we expect sex and recombination to take those intermediate types, recombine them, and increase the variation, produce some of the more extreme individuals in both the very highly fit and the very low fitness individuals. So it's only in these cases that we expect sex and recombination to increase in fitness and thereby, by increasing variation, allowing evolution to proceed more rapidly. Because the more variability, the more the faster the response to that selection will be. Okay, so that's problem number one. Sex doesn't always increase variation. It depends on the shape of the fitness surface. The second problem is not all variation is needed by selection. So I'm going to use another toy example, but this illustrates the more general point. So in this toy example, I flipped it around, and now the intermediates are more fit. After selection, we'll see more of the intermediates remaining in the population. So this population does not have as much variation anymore. And if it were to reproduce asexually, it would also not have very much variation. Sex, on the other hand, returns the population towards Hardy-Weinberg, increases the variation, but those variants are the very ones that have low fitness. They're the ones that, under that fitness surface, have the lowest ability to reproduce, survive and reproduce. So yes, in this case, sexual reproduction increases variation, but that variation hampers selection. It undoes what past selection did. Past selection eliminated those types. Sex has just brought them back. And again, while that's a toy example, it's generally the case that in a constant environment, when sex and recombination undoes genetic associations, randomizes them and produces offspring, the offspring that it's producing are the very ones that selection has eliminated in the past. And within a gene, we call this a segregation load, and between genes, we call this a recombination load. And those are very ever-present that we'll have when recombination and sex happen, that the offspring will undo the combinations that allow their parents to survive. So these are the poker problems, segregation load and recombination load. So that leads us to ask, if Weissman's explanation is iffy, why has sex ever evolved? And so the way that population geneticists address this question is by asking, well, let's imagine you have populations, and in these populations, genetic variants arise that change the rate of sex and recombination, and then just find out when can they spread. So do mathematical models and find out if a gene increases the rate of recombination or increases the frequency of meiotic sex versus mitotic asexual reproduction. Will it spread? So I'll be talking about we call those modifier genes. And if it spreads and increases the rate of meiotic sex, then that population will evolve a higher level of sex. So that's what we want to know. When will populations evolve and maintain a high level of sex in the face of these costs? OK. So the first class of models that address this question found the answer, never. This work was done by Mark Feldman, who proved what he called the reduction principle, and that is showing that modifiers increasing sex or recombination never spread in a population at equilibrium under constant viability selection. This is actually a pretty big problem, because now we've taken something that was a little bit mysterious and yet very commonplace, sex, and proven that the rate of sex and recombination will decline over time. But pay attention to the assumptions. The assumptions that the population's at equilibrium with constant selection. And I think what this really tells us is at equilibrium, there would be no need for variation in sex and recombination simply suffer from this higher load. So if the world were static, sex would be absent. And we must have to change that assumption, make the population not at equilibrium to explain sex. So it's like the poker hall again, but now you're changing the rules, where maybe next day or next year, what's a winning hand or what gets the most pay is maybe a little bit different. So that might be the answer to why we have sex and recombination. So the next generation of models, of modifier models, looked at that. Made the world not static, but changed. The population wasn't at a fixed equilibrium, but was constantly either facing a changing optimum in the environment or witnessing an onslaught of new mutations. And so in either case, you have this perpetual possibility of directional selection. And in these models, also initially started by Mark Feldman, what was found was that sex and recombination could increase. But it wasn't all the time. And the parameter space in which sex and recombination could increase was kind of a narrow parameter space. And I want to explain why. So first of all, for sex and recombination to be favored, we had to be in that zone where fitness surfaces are negatively curved and variation was depauperate to begin with because of past selection. So you need this negative curvature. In addition, the curvature can't be that strong, because if it's that strong, when sex happens and takes them over abundant intermediate types, increases the variation and produces the more extreme types, it's producing a lot of sick kids if the curvature is very, very strong. And when those sick kids die, they take with it the modifier gene controlling sex and recombination. And so what we'll see is the modifier will go down in frequency if that load is too high. And in addition, there can't be that much variation in the nature of this fitness surface, because when it's very strongly negatively curved, there's strong selection against sex and recombination. When it's positively curved between pairs of loci, there's very strong selection against recombination. And so it has to be the case that most of the pairs of loci in a genome have to fall within this sweet spot. Because if a good chunk fall outside of it, the selection becomes really strong against sex and recombination. So this sort of early work on the evolution of sex and recombination led to a lot of empirical work, very exciting work to try and estimate the nature of fitness surfaces. What are the shapes of these epistatic interactions? And my take on this work, this empirical work, is that we don't have a lot of evidence for negative curvature. In many studies, the average is positive or nearly zero, or sometimes it's negative, but not certainly not in all of the studies to date. The other issue is that the curvature can often be very strong. We can get very strong interactions where individuals survive unless they have a combination of alleles, and then they die. And that's a very strongly curved fitness surface. And one thing we know for sure is that the interactions between pairs of genes vary dramatically between pairs of genes. So that last point, that there can't be too much variation, I think we know for sure is not true. So the chances that biological systems fall within this narrow zone and do so for a majority of genes seems highly unlikely. And so I think at this point, a lot of us in evolutionary theory, we're feeling that this was perhaps wobbly ground for our understanding of the biological world when something as common as sex was not well explained. And most of the work that I and my colleagues have been doing over the last 10, 20 years is to try and figure out, okay, what are we missing in these models? What complexity is not here that are critical elements in the solving the enigma of sex? So things like selection varying over time, selection varying over space, individuals that maybe have more sex in response to stress or other features, things like that, they can contribute to the answer. But I really want to focus on this last one, populations are finite, because I think that's where the solution lies. So first of all, I haven't told you that any of the previous models, all of those previous models, assumed an infinite population, but they did. No population is infinite in size. And this, I claim, is like the spherical cow of physics. An infinite population is the spherical cow of population genetics. All populations are finite, and my job next is to show you that this actually makes a substantial difference to the outcome of the models. And that is what is surprising. And I think that's surprising because most of us think of stochasticity and drift as just adding a little bit of noise to the system, but not fundamentally changing the direction or outcome that we'll see in a set of models. And here's an example where the outcome, the nature of the outcome, depends on modeling it in a finite stochastic world. The other point that I want to mention is the reason why these models, it's a little bit like, well, that was kind of dumb. Why didn't you do those stochastic models before? Well, we got to remember, those models that we're talking about before with, let's say, two loci under selection, each with two alleles, and a modifier controlling the amount of recombination, also with two alleles, that we're talking about eight coupled nonlinear equations. So that was hard enough to analyze when in a deterministic setting. And now we're talking about needing to describe the frequency distributions of all of those chromosomes. So it's mathematically challenging as well, which is, helps explain why it took a while before these stochastic models were done. Okay. So I think, first of all, I want to give you some intuition for why modeling these processes in a finite population may actually make a difference. So I'm going to just give you a couple of scenarios where the finiteness really is critical. So in this first scenario, I'm imagining that there's a distribution of fitnesses in the world. Each individual has a combination of alleles that gives them a particular fitness. And now imagine that a new beneficial mutation appears. If this population is infinite, that new beneficial mutation will appear in all the possible backgrounds because there's an infinite number of all of those possible backgrounds. And in particular, that new mutation will happen in the fittest genotype because there's an infinite number of them. But in a finite population, this can't happen. That new beneficial mutation will appear somewhere in some genetic background linked to alleles at other loci. And it has a fairly small chance of actually occurring in the tail of high-fitness individuals. So here is an example where the finiteness completely changes our expectations of what is the chance that a new beneficial allele will, in very early on, be coupled with the fittest genetic backgrounds. And this problem was actually, I think, what inspired Fisher, R.A. Fisher in 1930. He had some description of the problem of the evolution of sex, and I think that this underlies it. Because he wrote, "For unless advantageous mutations occur so seldom that each has had time to become predominant before the next appears, they can only come to be simultaneously in the same gamete by means of recombination." He doesn't mention drift, he doesn't mention stochasticity, he doesn't mention the finiteness of the population, but if the world were infinite, if the populations were infinite, this wouldn't be a problem. They'd come to be instantly in the same genotype by mutation. So that's one way of thinking about this problem, and this one's known as the Miller-Fisher explanation for the evolution of sex. But I want to argue that more generally, stochastic models cause a whole series of similar problems, whether we're talking about new mutations, as in that previous example, or standing genetic variation that any population will have. And so here's another toy example of where we might imagine starting a population. Each of these is different, are different individuals with different chromosomes carrying some alleles, positive alleles, that maybe allow them to better adapt to a warming environment. And we imagine over time that this initial population then has variation in its ability to tolerate increased temperature. After a period of selection without sex and recombination, we'll see a more adapted population. But now look, after this period of selection, what has happened is all of the genomes that had two copies of the positive allele have gone to high frequency and essentially fixed. And so there's now no more variation in temperature tolerance. They all have two and only two. But there's still, so we'd say there's no additive genetic variance left. But there's still genotypic variation that's hidden with these pluses and minuses in different locations. And if sex and recombination acted then, it could release variation that was hidden because the surviving genotypes are the ones that are now all fairly equal in fitness. All equal in fitness, but not necessarily all genetically the same. So the finiteness, and then again, the finiteness of the population is critical. If this were infinite, we'd have the plus four plus types to begin with. And there's another, so we call this, these phenomena, where selection, we cannot look at selection at this site without knowing what's happening with respect to selection at the other sites within the genome. We call that Hill-Robertson interference. For those of you who are familiar with the terms clonal interference or Muller's ratchet, those are all examples of this same process, where selection is not happening independently on each locus, as in our standard population genetics P and Q examples, but they act on the whole genome. Okay, so then the next question is, all right, there's finite population effects. We've got Hill-Robertson interference problems where the fate of one allele on one depends on its background and not only on its fitness effects. But how much is that likely to select for sex and recombination? So this has been an evolving process of trying to answer that question. And over time, we've done some analytical models. And there are two main approaches that we've used to get at this analytically. One is to use a branching process model where we can ask, what is the fate of a modifier if it changes the backgrounds on which a new mutation occurs? And the second way that we've addressed this is by not just paying attention to the frequencies of each chromosome, but for about the variation in those frequencies so that we can take into account finite sampling. And here's just an example result from that second approach, looking at how much there's selection for recombination depending on things like how much variation there is at the selected loci, how much variation there is in the recombination rate, population size, and how tightly linked everything is to begin with. R. So if R is small, then these forces get very large. The most important point is not the nature of this function. The most important point for my talk is not the nature of this function, but that in an infinite population, that number is zero. And we can prove it's not zero in a finite population. Let me show you an example of simulations of this process, which I think are easier to visualize. So here you take a population, you subject it to a round of selection, a period of selection, and you ask, how much has the frequency of sex or recombination gone up over this bout of selection? That's what I'm asking. And that's what the y-axis shows. How much more sex is there after this bout of selection than before at zero? And just to orient us, let's start on the right-hand side where we have an infinite population. And in an infinite population, as I said before, you had to have negative epistasis for sex and recombination to be favorable, because that's when variation was missing in the first place. So we see positive selection for sex there. And if there's positive epistasis, the nature of the fitness surface is such that sex and recombination is a horrible idea. And we find selection against it. And if there's no epistasis at all, nothing happens. But that's only in an infinite population. In a finite population, those infinite population predictions are not informative. With a finite population size, regardless of the form of epistasis, we're seeing selection for sex and recombination. And indeed, the direction flips so that positive epistasis is actually more favorable to the evolution of sex and recombination, this line, than that one. And that's because those Hill-Robertson effects have tied up good alleles on bad genetic backgrounds. And when those are recombined, they have an even greater boost in fitness because of the positive curvature of the fitness surface. Now, a couple other things to point out. Why is it going down? It's going down if the population size is too small. You just drift and lose variation too quickly. And the other point that's interesting is, at first, I think most people would have thought, yes, this would matter, but only in really small populations. And here we're seeing population sizes of 10,000 and still seeing drift dominating whether or not sex and recombination evolves and not the infinite population dynamics. But still, there's lots of populations out there that are larger in size than 10,000. And so the question was, what about other models of selection? So this is a really simple one, only two loci under selection. And they were under fairly strong selection. So in a series of papers, colleagues and I have looked at what happens if you add more loci with weaker selection per locus or allow the population to be structured in space. And the key interesting feature is that in all of those cases, that peak continues to rise and shift to the right. As a matter of fact, if the population is structured in space, we were able to prove that if the population is infinitely large, but the deems aren't, the patches aren't, that the same processes of selection running out of accessible variation from that finite number of genotypes that are present was enough to favor sex and recombination. Again, just redoing those same graphs, but in a structured population, just to illustrate this point, The red curve is what we saw before. This total population size is 100,000. The black curve is what we would have seen had there been panmixio, random movement across the patches, so no spatial structure. That's what we had in the previous simulations. If there was 100,000 individuals, this is what we would have seen with no migration, so that the deem size is the population size. And the key point that I want to make is that even if migration rates are fairly high among the populations, so these are numbers that are more than one individual migrating between the patches per population per generation, we still see much stronger selection than we would have expected had everybody been mixing fully. And this is quite an interesting result then, because it's saying that these problems of selection running out of variation locally would apply to all potentially all species, not just those of small population numbers. That, and I've been talking about beneficial mutations, but I should say it doesn't matter whether or not these Hill-Robertson effects are caused by beneficial mutations or the opposite, deleterious mutations. And this is just an example of a simulation run where all we had was deleterious mutations, but they were appearing in random places within the genome, no epistasis between them. And yet, the genome increased the map length, increased the amount of recombination in this genome, basically because when recombination rates were low, that deleterious alleles, the beneficial alleles, would have deleterious alleles in their genome. So it's very hard for selection to pick out the very best alleles at a locus, because they were almost always in backgrounds with bad alleles. And this point with more recent work has been shown to be true more generally. It doesn't really matter what the nature of selection is. This, whether or not it's due to hosts and parasites co-evolving, whether it's due to a changing environment that's fluctuating or constantly moving in the same direction, whether it's beneficial mutations considered alone or combination of beneficial and deleterious mutations, it doesn't matter. The key element is that sex allows the fittest of those alleles to come together, and that because past selection has happened in finite populations, we're more likely to see the fit alleles on bad genetic backgrounds. If the fit alleles were on good genetic backgrounds, they would have already gone to fixation. So what we're left with are these kind of intermediate chromosomes, intermediate genomes, where sex can bring together the fittest alleles. I'm going to take just a moment to talk about a different problem. And that is to say, do we, over the long term, do these Hill-Robertson effects, have they actually allowed for the spread of more sexual organisms and then more asexual organisms? And to tell you that story, I want to introduce you to the evening primrose, Oenothera. For geneticists in the audience, the evening primrose is a really has a really strong historical record because it was studied by De Vries, who found these translocations among the sex chromosome, among the chromosomes. See, these are chromosomes, but they've undergone these series of rearrangements, translocations, so they pretty much only pair well at the ends of the chromosomes. And he called this a ring chromosome structure. So let's say the yellows are from the moms, the reds are from the dads. And moreover, and during meiosis, they pull apart in sets. So the maternal chromosomes all go to one egg, and the paternal chromosomes all go to the other egg. And in these crazy, well, they're called permanent translocation heterozygotes, the homozygotes with all of the yellow types don't survive, or this set only goes to pollen and this set only goes to eggs. There are different mechanisms in different species, but the net result is the offspring have the one yellow and one red set. So basically, it's gone through this complicated process to tear apart its genome and bring it back together with the exact same chromosomes without recombination and without independent segregation of the loci. So these flowers still have meiosis, still have flowers, and still produce pollen that unite with ovules, but they don't have recombination and segregation. So they don't have the features of sex that we think are important to allowing good combinations of alleles to come together. So what we've done recently is looking, so this is a tree, a phylogenetic tree of this group of evening primroses. The red dots at the top, which you won't, will hardly be able to see, are the ones that are those crazy PTH asexual-like species. The blues are the sexual ones. And the, what we can do is use the shape, the geometrical shape of this tree to infer such things as what is the effect of asexuality on the extinction risk, the transition rate back and forth between sex and asex, and the speciation rate. We use we've developed a likelihood model that does that, but intuitively the information it uses is really things like how fast do you see these multiple branching patterns one after another? And how long do the lineages tend to last? That gives you some information in a state, that gives you information about extinction. So the net result here, so I was interested, what is the long-term fate of the asexuals in this group? And it was full of surprises. So I want to share those surprises with you. First of all, the asexuals, the PTH type, speciated at a significantly higher rate than the asexual ones. At first, that might be surprising because I've just talked about how asexuals may be sluggish to evolve. But on the other hand, if they arrive in a new patch, there's no gene flow swamping and inhibiting their ability to adapt to that patch. So I think this result is consistent with adaptation and speciation to local environments not being swamped by sexual genes. The other thing that many of you might be wondering is, what species concept are you using for these asexuals? And here is an interesting case because they're still producing pollen. So biologists have taken pollen from the asexuals, taken pollen from the sexuals, crossed those plants, produced hybrids, and just ask, are those hybrids viable or not? So they can use the same biological species concept both for the asexuals and sexuals. That's a minor tangent, but I think it's interesting. We have to compare like with like when we do these kind of analyses. But my prediction was that over time, these asexual lineages, yes, they might speciate more, but their long-term fate was going to be extinction. And we found no evidence of that. The extinction rates might be somewhat different, but we couldn't tell them apart. But what we could say is that the extinction rate differences were nowhere near large enough to outweigh the speciation differences. And this is the difference between the speciation and extinction rate, and that's the long-term growth rate, basically, of the asexual type. So why aren't we surrounded by asexuals? Well, here's the interesting result from that study. The asexuals were switching back. They had a very high rate after a period of time of reverting to sexuality. And that can happen in a number of ways. Either some of those translocations could undo themselves, or you could get crosses between two related species, putting a maternal set from one species with a maternal set from the other species. Now you have two normally homologous sets of maternal chromosomes that can then undergo sex. So something that my colleagues are looking for right now. So what I think is happening and explains these results, but this is where I'm going to hypotheses, is that over time, the asexual populations, they speciate, but over time they start accumulating these deleterious mutations. They start being less and less able to adapt to a novel environment. They get slower and slower behind because of these Hill-Robertson effects. But rather, before they go extinct, a faster thing that happens is a reversion. And so sex is rescuing those asexual populations. And that process just happens for this group to be faster than this extinction process. And it'll be interesting to repeat this analysis in other groups. Because they're still producing flowers, because they're still undergoing meiosis, all of the machinery of sex is still maintained in this group. And so they have reverting is then easier because they haven't undergone degenerating mutations at all of the genes essential for sex. So that's something, for example, that I don't think Deloid rotifers can undergo. They've lost most of the machinery for sex. Anyway, I think I've mentioned all of those. Well, just in case. So the conclusions from this inference study were that the asexuals were more, not less, likely to speciate. And that might say something that diversification may be actually easier in asexuals without the swamping effects of gene flow, without the trading of genes through sex between populations. The other really important result that I think is, there's a few other studies that are really pointing in the same direction, is that asexuality is not a one-way street the way we used to think of it. And that high rates of reversion may be especially likely in PTH because all of the genes associated with flowers and meiosis are still maintained. But in the long run, I think that asexuality is not long-lived in this group, not because the populations went extinct, but because they reverted. So the disadvantages of asexuality, things like Hill-Robertson effects, clonal interference, Muller's ratchet, Fisher-Muller problems, all of those come together and accumulate and ultimately select for sexual reverdance. So I think more studies like this, long-term comparative analyses of what the fate of sexuals are over longer period of evolutionary time, plus experimental evolution studies, and we're getting more and more of them, for example, in monogonot rotifers where populations are being propagated in changing environment and the frequency of the sexual and asexual eggs can be tracked. Those sorts of experiments are giving us better handle on whether or not it is indeed these Hill-Robertson effects or spatial effects that are most important. Just to wrap up, going back to where I started, I actually am going to reverse what I said before. And I do think that sex and recombination generate variation needed by selection. But the reason that variation is needed or is missing is not because of the nature of the fitness surface. It's not because of the kind of whether or not there's epistasis that's positive or negative, but it's because the populations are finite. And in finite populations, it's a combinatoric problem with as many loci as we have in our genome and as many SNPs and other variants that we have in the genome that very soon, there may be hidden variation, but most of the individuals that have survived a period of past selection are roughly of equal fitness. And to progress further, beneficial alleles have to be brought together from different individuals. And with that, I think I will acknowledge my many collaborators over the years, including especially Mark. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Sally. I'm just going to make a couple of comments before asking for questions. What I want to do is underscore the importance of what Sally has said about genetic drift or finite population size for the evolution of sex. Because in the history of evolutionary biology, this is a very unusual and subtle effect. Now, population geneticists discovered genetic drift, the effects of population size, early on. Ronald Fisher and Sewell Wright in the 1920s worked out much of the theory that is still valid today. But they differed strongly on the importance of genetic drift. Fisher believed in a Darwinian view where, as Sally said, genetic drift was a minor, unimportant randomizing factor that simply distracted a little from the main force of evolution caused by natural selection. And in his view, which he modestly described as the fundamental theorem of natural selection, selection would always take you to an optimum. Now, Sewell Wright had a very different view, and he agreed with Fisher about the theory of genetic drift. He agreed that the fundamental theorem was correct mathematically, but he emphasized that natural selection would take you to a local maximum, a locally optimal combination of characteristics that you could not escape from, a species could not escape from under the effects of natural selection alone. And so for Sewell Wright, the role of genetic drift was to allow species to explore the phenotype space and move to higher optima that could not be achieved by natural selection. And in this way, he was really imagining genetic drift playing the same role that randomness does in many kinds of search algorithms. So like the simulated annealing or the Metropolis algorithm and other algorithms used in computer science. And he saw genetic drift as playing this fundamental role. Now, he and Fisher never agreed, and I think the field as a whole never settled on, and still has not settled on, whether Wright's or Fisher's view is totally correct. But what Sally has emphasized is an entirely different role of genetic drift, that it can lead species in the absence of sexual reproduction into blind alleys, where combinations of loci that affect fitness, either positively affect fitness by being advantageous or negatively affect fitness by being deleterious, cannot be broken up unless there's sexual reproduction. And in the presence of genetic drift, that will inevitably happen. And it's, even in very large populations, it will inevitably happen. And so I just wanted to call attention to the novelty of that view and the difference from other views of genetic drift that have been in population genetics for the last 100 years. So with that, I would like to call for questions for Sally.
Okay, I should just start talking. I'm not a population geneticist. I'm just a plain ordinary geneticist, and I was struck by the fact that epigenetics didn't even enter your discourse.
Right.
And the more we learn, at least in plants, the more we realize that epigenetics plays a huge role.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes blurs the distinction between Darwinian and Lamarckian evolution.
Yeah.
Because you have the phenomenon of hybrid vigor, which is partly epigenetic, partly genetic, and transgressive inheritance, which means you're generating something that's beyond the variation that you see in the parentals. But at the mechanistic level, one of the things that it is increasingly being documented is that both wide crosses and stress of a variety of kinds loosen the epigenetic constraints, mobilize transposable elements, and you're off and running.
Right.
I have a principle within the organism for generating new variation.
I'm smiling because my very first paper was on the evolution of methylation patterns in epigenetics, and we've done experimental work with that, and I entirely agree with its importance in biological systems. A couple of things to mention. When the epigenetic signals just toggle back and forth in a non-directed way, it's just sometimes the methylases fail to act, that I just see that as one end of a continuum of mutation rates. We have things like microsatellites that switch back and forth at fast rates, and I just see epigenetic signaling as switching back and forth even over the time course of a single individual's generation. And those really rapid mutational changes, those really relatively rapid, you know, we're talking about mutation rates on the order of the generation, not mutation rates on the order of 10 to the negative 10 per base pair. If the mutation rate's really, really high, then recombination becomes less of a problem because we're back in that situation where all of the possible variants will arise pretty soon on all of the different genetic backgrounds. But then there was the other type of epigenetic signaling that happens, or marks that happen in response to the environment, and I think we do need to do a better job of incorporating those in these type of models.
What we increasingly appreciate in plants is that there's a constant flow between transposable elements and genes, so that new regulatory functions arise by insertions, and conversely, transposable element transposases get co-opted into various essential functions, such as in our immune system, which evolved, where the recombination is carried out by proteins that evolve from transposomes.
And within generation, recombination effects.
So this is not just a toggling back and forth. It's really a repressible system for generating variation.
Yeah. Mark.
Sally, one of the things that characterized those cases where the reduction principle fails in the absence of drift was that there were more than one force acting on the system, namely something like inbreeding.
Male and female sex differences in selection. That's right.
So when you introduce drift into the system, if in all of those deterministic cases where the reduction principle failed, there were two forces acting. My question is, can you say that the in the case where drift leads, apparently, in the presence of selection, to increase sex or recombination, that it's due to the force of drift which produces a higher variance in the correlation between genes than one would expect on the basis only of the mean in the correlation?
Yeah, I see it that way, probably. So my mentoring. But I see the drift. So on average, drift just increases variation. Drift does not by itself cause linkage disequilibrium or genetic associations. On average, it's just as likely to make positive-positive as positive-negative interactions. It's the interaction between that variability and how selection acts on that variability and asymmetry of that that really is critical. So I agree with you in that broad sense. Melanie? Oh, sorry.
Yeah. This, I think, is a very naive question, but it seems in your studies you assume both sexes are identical. The only point of mating is to create genetic variability, but maybe I'm too influenced by my little knowledge of mammals or something, but if you assumed an asymmetry between the sexes, one was more risk-taking or something like that, wouldn't that? How would that change the analysis? Would it make it more... In those kinds of populations, would sex be more
advantageous?
Advantageous than it would in others.
So I've skipped so much of this rich theory, but that's your intuition is exactly right. In species where there's a male and female differences, sexual selection can actually favor sexual systems because basically females have another way of augmenting natural selection if they do choose their mates in a way that's correlated with fitness. So Anil Agarwal has done some of that work. But my view is that I want to explain something across the board. Most plants are hermaphroditic. They don't have separate male and female sexes. And that's true for a lot of the protist and single cellular organisms that were the first to evolve sex. So I think having separate male and female sexes makes interesting additional complications. But I'm hoping to get something that will be broader than that. But a very good intuition about the process.
So given your results, can you kind of turn them around and say, for the specific species that are not sexual, that have continued to be asexual, can you explain what characteristics of those species have prevented them from becoming sexual?
We want to do more of that sort of thing. The Deloid rotifers are a very interesting example. And bacteria are an interesting example. But let's start with the Deloids. They're highly dispersive. They're found, if you scoop air out at 50,000 feet, you'll find these Deloid spores. So they're large population sizes with a lot of global migration. So it might be in that kind of too large a population size, too much mixture zone. The other thing they do is they do a lot of horizontal gene transfer. And that's true for bacteria, too. So they may just be getting enough recombination by these other means that these forces favoring sex are weaker, and they get around the Hill-Robertson effects by other ways, by moving genes from individual to individual rather than through sex.
This may already be well understood, but so forgive the ignorance. Instead of the population being constant, if there is some exogenous stressor or sort of population bottleneck, does it skew one way or the other that you're more likely to see sexual reproduction?
That's a good point. The models that I've talked about held the population size constant. There has been work by Kurt Lively and Howard that had the population size kind of fluctuating because of host-parasite interactions. And then they weren't looking at the evolution of recombination, but they found that Muller's ratchet, which is an element of this, was stronger. So I think it'd be interesting to see. And my guess is that if the population goes through periods of time of low population size, that really is the generator of the drift, and that'll be a better predictor of the strength of these effects than the average population size. Not been done.
We have time for two more questions, and then we'll have to take a break.
Yeah.
Simon.
When sex is advantageous, what, if anything, does the theory tell you about with whom you should have sex? I mean, to the degree of assortativity in the, that would be desirable.
Well, so not addressed in these models. The other models that I mentioned were models where not all individuals undergo sex, and some are asexual and some are not. And there, the high fitness individuals shouldn't undergo sex, and the low fitness individuals, the high fitness ones evolve not to undergo much sex. The low fitness stressed individuals evolve to have higher rates of sex. And there, what's happening is it's really an abandoned ship mechanism. If times are tough and my genome's not working, then there's a lot strong selection for to mate with somebody else, and that can even be another low fitness individual.
But if deem size gets small,
yeah.
Should that favor outcrossing, reaching out to other deems?
That's right. That same model predicts those type of effects that. When stressed, or when either stressed environmentally or stressed genetically by inbreeding depression, you should see higher rates of sex evolving and higher rates of outcrossing evolving.
So I just have a question as an ignorant physicist, and
it's
I'm
hard
here.
Thank you.
But I'm just wondering, what determines the limit of when you are in the infinite population size and the finite population size?
Question.
Do you compare that to the size of the genome or the number of
No, there is
what?
Not. Initially, I had really thought that those humps were going to be pretty much right around 10,000 to 100,000 individuals, and so I thought we could experimentally see, do we see these forces going up and down? But then when we did these models where it depends on how many loci are under selection, the strength of selection on those organisms, that transition to the deterministic limit varies. So I cannot say ahead of time where we're going to see that peak come down. And I've had a standing argument with a friend, and he thinks that if in the limit, as the population size goes to infinity, but mutations continue to be unique, it may still be the case that these processes are driven, are important. So it just depends on what kind of limit you're taking. As the population size goes to infinity, do you get an infinite number of mutations or a finite number?
Thanks, Sally, again.